Greetings, and welcome to the Thirsty Mage, the podcast where a bunch of chums get together to drink a pint and discuss RPG-related content. I'm your host, David Lloyd, and tonight we'll be reminiscing about our favorite musical numbers from RPGs past. I didn't say we'd be talking about the best RPG music, necessarily, as I'm sure many of the entries will prove, but we are talking about our favorites, the ones that blew our minds, gave us goosebumps, and kicked us right in the feels. Before we get too deep, though, let's see who's on the episode tonight. He is the co-host of the Talk Nintendo podcast, and thoroughly enjoyed the 7th installment of the Halloween movie franchise, Mr. Casey Gibson.
Hello, hello. It's a pleasure to be back.
Pleasure to have you. I'm not sure if you picked up on the deep cut.
Oh, no, definitely not. I'm too tired. I was trying to think of like what the Halloween joke might have been, but then I just chose to ignore it.
Yeah. Well, so Casey's in on the joke. The title of the movie was H2O.
Gotcha. Yeah, there it is. Okay. I do have my handy great value purified drinking water bottle here, so
awesome.
Keeping it classy.
Also joining us, one of a trio of review editors for Nintendo World Report and fellow Zanky Zero survivalist, Mr. Jordan Rudick.
I think the best joke was when you said deep cut. Yeah, I don't have anything witty to say this time. I don't know. My witty thing was pointing out the joke in your introduction to Casey, so that's probably the best I could do. Hopefully I'll do better with my song choices later on, though.
And joining us tonight, fresh off the task of removing redundancies in the video game composer market, he is the host of Radio Free Nintendo, Mr. James Jones.
God, it'd be going from murder to like... All right, now we're going to pretend like I didn't say all those terrible things and just decide the composer of New Yoshi's Island really is a bane. Don't worry, it's not coming up tonight. My favorite RPG song, theme from New Yoshi's Island.
Oh, God.
Because you're playing a role of a survivalist going through that song.
Well, I can attest to my son was playing the demo to Yoshi on his Switch in the car. And I was about ready to throw the Switch out the window listening to the song. It is just so repetitive. It's like four notes. It's just burned into my head.
Take that and make it entirely out of kazoos.
That's right. And that that little wooden thing with all the ripples that you rub another piece of wood across.
Yep. The kazoo, God's mistake.
Oh, man, I had enough of that, so. I'll be deleting the demo as soon as I get my hands on it. So, well, before we get into the songs, maybe we'll just see if anyone has any drinks they want to mention that they're having at the pub tonight.
I have a job and it's like 11 p.m., so I got to stop. Also, I've been working since like 6 a.m., so I'm not having any of this.
Well, I need to keep the bartenders. Gotta help them pay the bills. So tonight I'm going with a Belgian wit from Mill Street Brewery.
Are you implying you're putting her through college? Is that what this is about?
Putting someone through college.
She ain't going to nursing school. I gotta warn that to you. I'm sorry. It's an act.
Well, getting my money one way or another.
I'm not gonna say anything. I'm gonna walk into all kinds of trouble. John's not here to absorb the blow of me getting us in trouble, so I'm gonna walk away.
Oh man! So the way we're going to work tonight is we all four of us have three songs that we feel very strongly about. So we'll go through them. Usually we don't mind going the 3 or 4 hours, but tonight, like James said, we all got jobs, so I'm gonna be the disciplined host this week and actually cut her short. So we're gonna say max 5 minutes per song and go through and talk about why we like them and what we think of them, and then we're gonna finish up with two surprise songs at the end, one from James and one from myself, and we'll see which one is more bullshit than the other.
Yeah, it wasn't an intention to be bullshitty here and come up with a surprise. It was just a matter of like, well, it's my favorite, not the best, so let's do this.
Yeah, that's kind of where I am. It's like, I enjoy it, but we'll see how much ribbon I take for it. So, well, how about we kick it off with Casey giving us his first entry.
Alrighty. Well, at first I was thinking, you know, generally we're talking JRPGs, so at first I didn't even consider this song, but I decided to go with good old classic Diablo 2, one of my favorite games of all time, and I know Jordan is a big fan as well. And we're going with the classic Rogue. Earlier songs, it's pretty much, it plays in the first encampment, which is the Rogue encampment, as you might have guessed. And it's just, it's beautiful. It's so good. And it also just has such nostalgic, you know, ties to so many hours spent in this game. And, you know, that was sort of the first, you know, your first, you're welcomed, you know, to this music, you know, when you first get into the game here. And the composer is Matt. I'm going to mess this last name up. Yulman? Is that how you might pronounce that, perchance?
Sure enough.
Yeah, and he was with Blizzard, you know, so he did work on Diablo, StarCraft, which also has a really great soundtrack, Diablo 2 and its expansion, as well as some World of Warcraft stuff before moving on to Runic Games, where... you know, he did some work on Torchlight and Torchlight 2, which is essentially Diablos. And then Hob, which actually just released for the Switch, I think, what, last week?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's a really great soundtrack. Like I said, it's sort of slow paced, but then the guitar kicks in a little later, and oh, man, just so good.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one thing about that particular track in Diablo 2, Casey, that you think you've alluded to, is that it does a really good job of connecting the second game with the first, right? You play it in the Rogue camp at the start of Diablo 2, and I think there's a lot of notes there, a lot of sounds you hear that remind you of Tristram from the first game, right? So it does that really nice job of reminding you, hey, remember the first game? Like, okay, this is the second one. It's not all that different. Like, you're still going to be doing a lot of the same things, mm-hmm, but this world is obviously going to be a lot larger. So kind of start you off with something familiar right at the beginning.
Yeah, and I remember, it's funny, actually, the first time I ever played Diablo 2 was I was going over to my friend's house for a sleepover, and my brother had, you know, we had Diablo, so we're like, oh, we're going to play Diablo online, you know, it'd be great. And then, like, I walked in and was just, like, punched in the face with, like, my friends, like, we've got Diablo 2. And, like, I don't know how at the time I didn't realize another Diablo was coming out. I was young and dumb. And I was just like, oh my God, like, this is incredible. And I felt bad because, like, totally just, like, ignored my brother trying to play Diablo 1 because we're like, no, dude, like, we're playing Diablo 2 right now.
They're such different games in the way that Diablo 1 is really focused on the one town and the one dungeon, and you're just going deeper and deeper, right? But Diablo 2 feels like this whole world that you're exploring. You're going to different landscapes, different environments, and the soundtrack does a really good job of, I guess, kind of painting that picture that every place you visit is quite different, even though it's that kind of hell spawn or those demons that are taking over, and you're still kind of fighting to, you know, I guess, to drive them all back or preserve life as we know it.
Oh, David, have you either of you played a good old Diablo?
Not two. I've played 3 on Switch, but that's the extent of my Diablo experience.
I'm reasonably confident I poked at the original Diablo when it was new, so quite a while ago. But I know I never played 2.
All right, yeah, 1 is really great game too, but yeah, the second one really just like tenfold better.
It's good to start with some Western composer love right off the bat, because when I was doing my list, there wasn't a whole lot of Western composers coming up in my head.
It all goes downhill from here for that in that respect. It's like, okay.
That's right, yeah.
Everybody else, get out.
Don't expect this. Yeah, this is not a trend we're setting no, here.
They're going to be few and far between. So.
Anybody else who speaks English from this point forward is purely anecdotal.
Yeah. Alrighty, well, it's about time we'll move on to the next one. So, Jordan, if you want to give us your first one.
So the first one I chose, to me, it was the one I was definitely going to talk about. It's one of my favorite just video game songs of all time, or themes of all time. And that's the boss battle theme from Final Fantasy IV. JRPGs are known for having really good music, of course, and I think it's really important, or maybe we really gravitate towards the boss battle themes or the combat themes, because there's so much fighting that goes on, and because it's often these games are turn-based combat, sometimes there isn't just a lot of battles, but there's also a lot of long battles. So it's really important that these fighting themes or boss themes are really catchy, and you don't mind listening to it loop a bunch of times, because you could get really bored of it easily, right? So the nice thing about the boss battle theme in Final Fantasy IV in particular is you hear it really early in the game. About 10 to 15 minutes into the game, you have your first boss fight with the Mist Dragon, who ends up being Rydia's mother. Of course, you don't know this at the time, but it kind of foreshadows this really early on in the game that you are going to fight a lot of boss fights. There's going to be a lot of tense moments to come, because you've just kind of started this adventure. You've barely walked anywhere. You go through a very short dungeon, and then you hear this boss theme for the first time. And you're good. Like I said, it's going to keep coming up again and again. There's a lot of boss fights in this game. The song is a really great kind of mix, or I guess it's got this fast-paced percussion in the background that really drives it forward. It kind of makes your heart race, right? It raises that tension, like I said. And then the song slows down in the middle of a little bit. It's a little bit more triumphant, or a little bit more like a ballad kind of sound. And then it kind of builds to this kind of smashing crescendo again before the track loop. So there's kind of these three phases of the song. They're all really distinct, and I think really make it pretty epic sounding. I think it's a hard song to get tired of, because it's so effective at pumping you up, keeping you engaged through every boss fight. So I always looked forward to the boss fights in particular, because I knew I'd get to hear this song. It's currently my ringtone on my phone. I'm definitely obsessed with it. I've listened to a ton of remixes of the songs, different versions of it, from all the versions of FF4 that have come out. I still think I like the Super Nintendo one the best. Maybe I'm the most familiar with that. It's got the most nostalgia for me. So that's the kind of version that I submitted to you, David.
Yeah, and I mean, Matsu's got so much to choose from too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, like the Final Fantasy soundtrack, or Final Fantasy soundtracks I should say, like Uematsu Matsu has done just such a great job, and obviously one of the most memorable composers. Everyone knows that name. He's synonymous with the franchise, basically. And this is, it's not necessarily my favorite track of his, but it is definitely my favorite fighting song or boss battle theme that he's done. I think it's the best one in the series, at least for me. What do you guys think about this one? Is it one you're familiar with, or you've never heard it before? Or
yeah, I've heard it, and I can kind of hear it in the back of my head, but it's one of those, like, for like a lot of those games, Uematsu could kind of develop. A, he was having to make these games fairly fast, mm-hmm. And B, he had sort of settled into his style. So I just listened to it, so I know which one we're talking about. But before mm-hmm. I clicked on it, I was like, "Which one is this?" Oh,
yeah,
it is really good, which is why he got to mm-hmm. make so many of these things. I find it interesting that his style really starts to shift. I guess around now it's starting to shift, but you see him get pretty wild. Mm-hmm. A couple years down the road, where most of his work in 7 is like brooding and kind of to the point where it's a little bit bad, like not bad, but like he's obviously coming to terms with the PlayStation sound hardware, and it just has this kind of like dark brooding feel, which seems off compared to all the kind of resplendent Super Nintendo stuff he could do. And then you get to the Golden Saucer theme and you're like, oh, here he is. All right, this is really fun.
He's back.
Yeah.
So this is kind of like peak Super Nintendo era stuff for him. And I think it really shines in that respect.
Yeah, I mean, it's the first Super Nintendo Final Fantasy game that he was composing for, and I feel like maybe he was taking some risks or trying new things, and I think this is one of those themes that really worked out for him. I compare it kind of really directly with FF5's battle theme, which I think is similar, but I don't find it as memorable or as enjoyable to listen to. And then you get to FF6, and by that time, you know, I think the combat themes, the boss battle themes are kind of all over the place. They're certainly good, but I don't think they're as catchy, or maybe on loop, I don't think they sound as good as this one does. That's for me anyways.
Yeah, I'd say they're more complex compositions, because I think he's more comfortable in the space, but maybe they're not like the core melody isn't necessarily as refined, because he feels the need to do more of a wall of sound style of music composition.
That makes sense.
So we'll have to move on, but we're not moving on far, because the next song is my favorite song, and it's also a Matsu from Final Fantasy VIII, and that's Liberi Fatali. Opening sequence. There's nothing like two knuckleheads slashing their faces with swords to get you psyched for the upcoming adventure that you're going to be going on.
But I thought Final Fantasy VIII sucked.
Yeah. Well, if you've listened to like even one of the other episodes of the Thirsty Mage, it's no surprise that Final Fantasy VIII is one of my favorite RPGs, if not the favorite. I mean, there's a lot of great music in Final Fantasy VIII, but the first one is really what, I guess it's just because I hear it and I'm like, oh, it's starting, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that opening sequence is one of the better opening sequences in a Final Fantasy, just because the pace of it is just like setting up kind of that, the dichotomy between the Cypher and Squall, and that there's going to be this rivalry throughout the game, and then kind of showing some scenes from, you know, that are going to be coming up in the game, and to kind of give you that preview and to set the tone. So, and then, I mean, this is the first game that he actually gets to use like actual like instruments and stuff too, right? Because Final Fantasy VII was still using the chip.
Seven's all chip tunes. Yeah, with maybe like one exception, but yeah, I think it's all chip. No, there's no Red Book. It's all chip tunes.
Yeah. Yes. So this is kind of like Matsu unleashed to me.
Yeah, they broke the chains.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I was thinking I'm not really familiar with Final Fantasy VIII very much or the music of it. And when I hear this, just comparing it to VII directly, it is totally like, now just go and do whatever you want. Like, this is, you know, just paint on your canvas, you know, blank slate kind of thing. Like, this is an amazing song, actually, David. I'm really glad you turned us on to it. It's really all over the place, like bombastic and kind of dips and dives, hills and valleys kind of thing. And what a good, when does this occur? You said,
yeah,
the
like
of
this
the game,
is
or?
the opening cinematic.
Yeah, the opening cinematic.
Oh, right on.
Which is an intensely 90s thing, where you have these two guys with the 90s haircuts possible, in incredibly 1990s outfits, with like goddamn gun swords, which is just stupid in the right way. having their dumb little pre-Matrix sword fight, it's like, oh man, we're really getting in here, aren't we?
And you don't even realize at the time that it's not even a real fight. They're actually just training out in the backyard.
Yeah, but they don't like each other, because they're rivals. Yeah, it's Like, you could slap some dumb title on there and convince me it's a 90s anime.
Yeah.
Like, you, oh, yeah, we're here. Yep, this is some, perfect. Like, mid-teens 90s anime. Here we go. Got it. Yeah. Does this song cover the transition to the battle scene? The not D-Day?
I think it does.
Yeah. Yeah, it gets... This is also the CG team unleashed, where they've just decided, like, we have a budget now!
Yeah. Well, and they and, really utilize it early in the game. Because, yeah, like you said, that scene where they're, like, all jumping off the boats and storming. I can't think of the town's name for whatever reason. But, when they're, like, leap. And then when they're running back. Like, that's one of my favorite scenes, too, is when they're running back to the boat. And then Squall, like, leaps across the beach. And Quintus is, like, laying out a machine gun into the spider robot. Like, it's just...
We saw Saving Private Ryan! it took 19 computers 4 weeks to render this. Yeah, it's so much going on in that scene.
All right. Well, how about we'll go with James? How you give us your first one for the list?
Yeah, we're rolling deep into the Mitsuda category here. We got some that story Mitsuda from Chrono Cross. This was a mess because Chrono Cross's soundtrack, I think, is probably some of his best work, just song to song, because it's sort of what we talked about with Final Fantasy VIII. He's unleashed now. He has instrumentation. Mm-hmm. He has vocals. And if you followed Mitsuda's career, if you give him access to singers who can perform Celtic-style lilts, guess what he's going to do? He's going to hire all of them. And he will spend your money, and you can't stop him. And he sure did. So I could have gone with Time Scar, which is sort of a song everybody thinks of. It's sort of the intro theme for this game. Could have gone with I spent 9 other songs that are like really famous that you may not even know where they come from. But I went with Radical Dreamers, which is a much more subdued theme. Just a guitar for the most part and a singer singing in Japanese, and she's singing kind of softly. There's no real dynamics in the song. It doesn't really go up and down in terms of volume. It'll trail off in a lot of places because the song is kind of slow and punctuated, but it's just like this really gentle melody with the single line accompaniment that sort of takes down the intensity from everything else in this soundtrack, which runs the gamut. But there's a lot of he's playing with the fact that he can basically studio record as many tracks as he want and just put them all into one audio track, versus when you have chiptunes where you're limited. There's a fixed number you can do before you've maxed out the sound hardware. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of songs, Time Scar being one of them, where he's basically just throwing things into the mix and bringing them back out. And there's a lot of songs where he's gone and thrown his vocalist in there to let them show their full range. This song, which is a much more somber tone, sort of ties all that stuff down and really goes with what the end of this game ends up being, which if you've made it through to the end of this game, sure is a thing. Like, holy crap, the end of this game is nonsense. And it's kind of an interesting theme for what essentially, it's not kids' theme, I don't think. Maybe it kind of is. But like, contrasting to her character, I mean, it is related to her. Is pretty much night and day. It's just a really like nice and melodic song, almost lullaby like in some ways, compared to everything else on the soundtrack. But it's such a good soundtrack that basically you could pick any song off the. I want to say it's like 3 discs. Like this is where things got out of control over at Square. Like this exact moment, things have lost. Like the train is off the rails now. Things that. The music team needs to be stopped. This is the point where somebody should have stopped them. But I think the official soundtrack's like 3 discs or some insane number like
yeah, I'm
that.
I'm pretty sure it's that.
And this is what where you just pick anything. It's just this one stands out because it is so different. It's not like Time Scar, which is a song everybody thinks of, which is just perfectly synchronized to this opening cinematic, which is really just an AMV. Somebody took that song and made an AMV of all the other cutscenes in this game, threw the logo on it, and called it a day. They just did a really good job of it. Yeah. And there's so many stupid characters in so many insane cutscene moments in this game that you could do that. At one point, there's a lion dude, and then there's a jester, and it's like, what is happening in this? This game looks crazy. And guess what? It's a pretty insane game.
With Mitsuda, it's like he's another one of those composers where you hear the song and you know it's him. He's got that style. You say yeah. Mitsuda, and I just say flutes, violins, and as many vocalists as they can fit into the room.
Yeah, and none of that's here. All this is a guitar for them. I think there's a little bit of some back. It's really just an acoustic guitar and a singer.
There's something interesting about the song and the fact that it has only those two components. And I wouldn't say one overpowers the other. They're kind of have a really good balance between them, right? Like the guitar and the vocals, you kind of hear them at an equal level, I feel like.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that normally happens. Like, I feel like maybe in a song with vocals like this, the vocals would kind of be the thing you hear the most or the thing that sticks with you the most. But the guitar is really strong throughout, I guess, because it's, yeah, maybe one of the only or certainly the most pronounced instrument that's used in the song. So that's kind of an interesting thing here.
Yeah. She's definitely carrying the primary melody, but the guitar is acting in a pure harmony role. So essentially, yeah. It's not accompaniment because there's not lots of pieces. It's really just here's the melody, here's the harmony that goes with it, and so they're constantly moving together. And she trails off a lot; like she'll hit a note and she'll slowly bring her volume down. And the guitar will do the same. So they sort of emulate one another, but not always in sequence either. So you get moments where one sticks out more than the other. But yeah, from a purely dynamic standpoint, they're really right there next to each other. It almost feels as if she's playing it while she sings, although I guarantee you she wasn't.
No. I'm glad you put a Chrono Cross song on your list, because I had one as my fourth song before we cut it down a little bit, and I had Home Arnie, which is definitely my favorite one. Radical Dreamers is a really good sound, really good track on this, on an unbelievable soundtrack as well as
with Matsu. Mitsuda is the only composer on here to see two songs chosen, and Casey's number two is by Mitsuda as well.
Yeah, and it's also another soundtrack that you could seriously pick any song from it, and it's amazing, you know, and that's Chrono Trigger. So many iconic songs. I mean, obviously, such a legendary game, and the soundtrack, I think, matches how good of a game it is. And I'm picking Black Omen. Crops up later in the game when you're going through, the end area there, the Black Omen Temple, right? It's just called Black Omen, right? I believe in the game, and it's got such a it's like obviously it's got like a very ominous sort of feel to it, but also like the bass kicks in, and it's a short bit, you know what I mean? It's not like a super long song, and when you're in the temple, you know what I mean? It plays over and over again, but it's just one that completely stuck with me in a collection of, like I said, in a collection of songs that are so great, this one just always stuck with me. And, like, I just find myself going back and listening to it from time to time. And another just great, Chrono Trigger. And it's funny because I got into Chrono Trigger so late. Like, I'd owned it for Super Nintendo because, again, my friend was like, this game's amazing. And I played a little bit of it here and there. And for some reason or another, it just never clicked, whether it just another game came up that, you know, ended up playing or whatever. But then finally, I guess at this point, it was a couple years ago, finally made it all the way through, and oh man, what a fantastic game.
The funny thing about this track in particular is, yeah, it's in the final dungeon of the game, and it's kind of fast-paced for a final dungeon rather than more epic-sounding or maybe a little bit slower. I think that's kind of the funny thing about this one. It kind of moves you through, which is probably the longest dungeon and certainly the most challenging one in the game, at a good clip because the song has a fast pace to it as well, something that really stands out about it to me anyways.
Yeah, I mean, it sets the tone for sure. Like, all the songs through at Chrono Trigger, like, you always, wherever you are, the music is matching what you should be feeling.
The craziest thing to me is that this is really the first time he's in the composer role. He had done some sound programming at Square for a while, but, like, he had Uematsu and Matsueda, who does a bunch of Front Mission music, in sort of secondary roles on this one, but they basically just gave him this game and said, go. Like, here's your shot at it. And he ended up putting out, like, this amazing soundtrack that's kind of shocking. And then immediately he turns around and does the visual novel Radical Dreamers, which is in the same franchise, a year later. And you realize, like, oh, he's actually amazing, isn't he?
Yeah.
like, right out of the gate, like, oh, he's a genius. And that holds until you get to 1998 when he does freaking Mario Party for some reason. Did you realize he's actually a terrorist? Yeah.
They must have had a feeling about him though, because it's such a dream team working on Chrono Trigger, and then to be like, okay, it's time for the songs. Just give it to this guy.
Yeah,
he's never led one.
Yeah, I mean, he had people who were experienced, I would assume, providing guidance. But I mean, yeah, he studied this. I mean, this is his area of study, and you see this especially in the 90s and the 80s, where it's somebody's like, hey, I'm a composer, but I'm gonna start working as like sound engineering, because I guess it's just a hierarchical thing. Like, I'm gonna write music. Well, guess what, kid? First, you're gonna program the bleeps and bloops of Final Fantasy IV. So I guess this was just like, it was finally his turn, and they gave him this giant project,
and he killed it. Yeah, he nailed it.
Almost killed himself, but he killed that
dude. Yeah, for sure.
Stomach ulcers.
All right, Jordan, going on to the next chiptune song.
Sure. So the next one for me is a track from Earthbound called Home Sweet Home. Suzuki. Home Sweet Home is another track you hear pretty early on, after you wake up in the middle of the night. There's kind of this funky sound, something mysterious is happening. You find this meteorite and you learn about your destiny from a bee, you know, really, really kind of funny beginning. But then the night passes and the morning comes. You go back inside your home just before the game, just before your adventure really starts, and this is the track that plays whenever you go back home. You hear the song, you know, throughout the game, whenever you return back to Ness's home, kind of becomes synonymous with the game's main themes. This idea of, you know, the journeying away from home for the first time, but also this longing to go back, right? There's a kind of that you always have that attachment to where you came from. And I think Earthbound is a, you know, Mother 2 or the Mother series, always that thing you come back to, your mom, the home where you grew up and your sister, all that stuff. The first notes of the song are a little quirky and almost deceptive. You're not sure exactly what kind of song it's going to be. But then at about the 10 or 12 second mark, it becomes really positive, uplifting. And you realize, oh, this is just entirely a lullaby, right?
Very soothing.
Very much so. The slow pace of it, the kind of the positivity, the uplifting nature. Yeah, this is a song that you're meant to kind of fall asleep to, or it's supposed to kind of lull you into a, you know, state of comfort or a state of security, something like that. I find that there's something memorable about the kind of punctuating high notes that build up in the song about, you know, maybe 30 or 40 seconds in. It's kind of like, you know, the game's obviously very, very difficult. There's a lot of grinding. It's not all that forgivable either, or forgiving, I should say. But it's a game with a lot of charming tracks, a lot of charming music like this that just fit the aesthetic and the mood so perfectly. Earthbound's a really wacky, kind of oddball kind of game, but the music is always on the same page as the aesthetic and the gameplay. And so, you know, I think this is one of those songs that really nails that too. I don't know if anyone else in the calls even played Earthbound. I know David hasn't gotten to it yet. I know top of his list to play.
I played as much as I could before I was like, fuck this.
Well, you would you probably would have heard this.
But like, this game doesn't really stick with me, so I don't really remember the song. But there is some interesting the tonality of the music in this game is a bit different from what you would expect. But I guess that sort of goes hand in hand
with the whole game.
This game's tonality being goofy, for lack of a better word.
It's not lots of series of bleeps and bloops. Like, it's very kind of, I don't know how you would call it, like. Like, obviously, this isn't the only song that sounds like a lullaby, but I think it is one of the most common ones that is remixed by people, right? Home Sweet Home. I think it's either a version of or a remix itself of a song called Pollyanna, which I think showed up in Mother 1 as well. So I haven't played Mother 3 yet, so I'm not sure if you get some version of this track in that game as well, but I think it just sounds really familiar to me. I've definitely heard this in a lot of other places too.
Yeah, I haven't played Earthbound in quite a bit, but I do remember this song pretty well. Like you said, it just sort of puts at ease, you know? Like, when you're hearing that song, it's like, all right, there's nothing to worry about.
Yeah, there's a lot of places in Earthbound where the music is meant to make you feel like, okay, this is a safe place, nothing bad's going to happen, or maybe there's going to be some funny interactions or funny dialogues here, but you're not in danger. And I think this is one of those tracks that really kind of solidifies or epitomizes that. Like, you're at home, you can rest here for free, and they're not going to charge you $1,000 like some of the later inns do in the game, right? Like, this is a place where everything is free. You can also do the item exchange with Tracy, your sister. It's really kind of a nice place to be in the game. Maybe the safest place you can be in the game as well. Home Sweet Home.
My next pick is the only other Western composer that's made it to our list. This one is the Dragonborn theme by Jeremy Soule for Skyrim. This one was because it's one of those ones that gives me goosebumps when I hear it, because it's really kind of like a call to arms type song, where it starts off slow and it just builds louder and louder and louder the as it goes, and it's almost like a marching theme, and it's like, it's classical music, but it has like throat singers that are kind of building up as it goes as well. And it's just like, Skyrim is one of my for Western games, it's probably my favorite Western RPG, and it's just like, and you hear it a lot in the game, and there's, like, when you get the new shouts and stuff, like, you kind of get, like, that, again, like, that kind of throat singing, like, build up. And it just reminds me of going on adventures in Skyrim, because the Skyrim's so big, and there's so much to do, and I just have a lot of fond memories of spending a lot of hours going around and just causing chaos. Like, one of my favorite parts of Skyrim is being in the Dark Brotherhood. So essentially, like, a lot of my time is just killing people. and just having that music kind of in your mind while you're walking the mountain regions of Skyrim, it just, like I said, it just gives me goosebumps. It gets me pumped. It's just, so that's why it's one of my favorites.
It's such an epic sounding music track. Like, it's constantly bum 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 bum. It's like, it got a great pace to it as well, and I can definitely see how this kind of keeps you pumped up and keeps you wanting to go forward in the game. I think that the singing adds a lot to it, right? The throat singing. It's now they're speaking. Is it? I don't want to guess at the language, but it's not like a language from the game. Like, it's a real language.
Yeah, I can't obviously remember. Like, it's kind of based in like Norwegian, like the North, because they're Nordics, right? In Skyrim.
Yeah, it looks like something like that, because the video you posted in the show notes, it's got the lyrics as well, which is really cool. I've never seen that before. Like, I've obviously heard this song a bunch. I've played through Skyrim probably 3 or 4 times, but I've never seen the English lyrics or translation of these the lyrics from this song. So that's kind of cool to see too.
I guess Jordan and I are probably the only ones that play Skyrim.
It's on the list, but it's like, oh man, I have to give something 100 hours. I don't have 100 hours to give you.
I played the very first mission, and I was like, wow, this is incredible. Because it was like, go to this cave to do this. And then, like, I just was presented with so many different options to turn on so many different people. And I was like, wow, this game is incredible. And then I finished that quest, and that was the end of it.
I dropped the quest.
Was it the paralyzed with fear feeling? Yeah. Oh, God, well, there's too much.
Yeah.
Too many choices.
I can't.
Like, I just...
I need my hand held.
I just dropped the main storyline altogether when I play. And I just, like... Because I love how it keeps it running total of... Or, like, tracking all of your open missions, and quests. So I've just got like 30 or 40 quests going on at one given time, and I'm just moving on to the next. And I mean, all the fun parts to me are like the non-story stuff anyway. Like, I love messing around with the Daedra. They got some of the best quests because they're like so screwed up, like especially like the tricksters and the evil ones. Like, so yeah, it's just, yeah, I'm a big fan of it.
Just one other note about the song. Like, I feel like it really does make you feel like this is an epic fantasy world where you're going to play a really important role. Like, you are important here. You are the Dragonborn. You have the power to, you know, destroy dragons, destroy, you know, evil mages, all these different kind of creatures and human beings you're going to encounter. Like, you can become this all powerful, almost a deity like figure, you know. It's a this track in particular. I think there's other good great music in Skyrim that, you know, helps with the, there's a lot of places or sections where you're traveling kind of long distances with just the environment noise and stuff, but I think this is a good song for, yeah, like you said, pumping you up and making you feel really important, or that you can make a big impact in this fantasy world.
And speaking of fantasy worlds where you can just go around doing shit, we have James' next one.
Yeah, so I harangued over Zeta Blade's representation on this, because honestly, I could put together 3 games, one from each soundtrack, and it'd be fine. Fresh off me killing Hiroyuki Sawano in Radio Free Nintendo no less than 6 days ago, because we're recording on a Wednesday. I was deep in thought in this game today when I was supposed to be working, because people were, the conversation about this game spiraled back up in my Twitter feed, which happens sometimes, and I have to remember why. And I'm like, oh yeah, because I killed him. And so I was kind of poking through some songs on the soundtrack, and like, yeah, Guillaume threw the new LA theme in there, which is just an abomination, just ghastly. If you haven't listened to RFN, I think it's 618. It's the one Bath does in the title. That, like, we're having a conversation about him, and Guillaume drops the yeah. What?
It's a special kind of bad
song. Yeah, but it's beautiful. Yeah. And he threw in the song I mentioned, which is the fight against tyrants, where it's literally somebody rapping about being stuck on this planet and how it sucks. And in fact, one of the lyrics is "This world sucks." Because just like Mitsuda, Sawano has a goddamn type, which is like, how much can I pump the action up to an absolute extreme? He came out of composing for himself, like releasing albums, which that was the first thing he did professionally, and then doing a lot of TV. Like, he was primarily TV, and then he started filtering into live action TV, and then he started filtering into anime. He's really only done a few games, and most of them are games that tie into anime he already composed. And he's definitely got a theme. It's loud, it's in your face, it's multi-melodic, so there's usually like two or three contrasting melodies in the theme. It's a lot of instrumentation. It can get into weird rap sometimes when he does vocal work, but sometimes it's just really booming singing. But he's capable of taking it all down. And so there's two themes in Xenoblade X that do it. One of them is Celica's theme, which is fantastic. But the one that I picked, because he can't name shit without being a complete nuisance to society, he names this song RX-46-RI9. What's that about? I don't know. It's the theme to Silvalum. Specifically, it's the night theme that's of interest, because Silvalum is like this snow-covered paradise in northern Mira. It's basically like the North Pole, but populated by sentient fire alarms. So like, you'll go around and these mechanical nightmares will pop up and just ace your party because they're like level 210 or some bullshit like that. And so they look like they're stationary, but they just pop up. And the Silvalum's the one place where the day theme is relatively benign. It's kind of calm, and usually his day themes in this game are loud and in your face, and the night theme is the soft and gentle one. But it's flipped in this one. The night theme, it's not really, it's still a fairly soft song, although it builds beautifully. The day theme is actually really quiet. The night theme's the one I really like, because it has this nice build up. And then because it's Sawano's song, even though it's this like heavy string section, like there's a bell section in the song, he still puts a drop in there like he's composing dubstep because he has to. He can't help himself. And it works really well in this place that feels very out of sorts for Mira. It's very peaceful, very quiet. It's not overwhelming. The visuals in Xenoblade X are overwhelming. You'll come to places with these giant torus made out of lava just above the horizon. Like, what the hell is that? This isn't right. Or you're in this really thick jungle with, like, King Kong every 3 feet. You get to Silvalum, and it's just white. There's some hills, there's mountains, but it's overwhelmingly white until you encounter, like I said, giant fire alarms that want to kill you. But generally speaking, it's like, the most visually relaxing area, and so it meshes here. And yeah, this song's really good. Like, it has a very nice flowing melody. He's not jamming two or three melodies into the song. There's no weird rap lyrics on top of it. The singer Emir doesn't come in and just belt out these like really powerful. It's just, he has a melody, he holds to it. There's a weird unnecessary drop in the middle, but that's fine, because it picks right back up where it left off. It's just a really pleasant song. Compared to most of his stuff, which can be very some of his vocal tracks in this game are really good, but they're not pleasant. They're intense.
James, I think you make a good point about the distinction between the day and night themes here. I agree with you. I like the night one a little bit better too. The day theme for Silvalum is almost too subtle. It's almost you barely notice it compared to the night one, which is, you know, it's a lot more. It's not in your face, but it's a lot more pronounced. Like, and it, you know, like I said, it does build to some really nice crescendos and sounds too. I mean, Xenoblade Chronicles X is a game about exploring these wide open areas, right? These big, right. Huge, larger than life spaces. So you need music that kind of. It's traveling music. It makes you feel like, okay, I do want to spend time exploring this because the music is so pleasant. It drives you forward, right?
It takes the opposite of Breath of the Wild's approach where the music's ambient. In this one, the music is, for the same reason, is ultimately a character. It's reinforcing these extreme areas because it's Breath of the Wild doesn't have, I mean, it has the extremes, but it doesn't just go like, you are now in lava place. Whereas this game does. Silvalum is nocturnal, mostly. And that's why the music's inverted. Things get dicier at night in Silvalum in a lot of ways, to the point where like it's probably better to just find a place and camp at night. And there's no camping mechanic in this game. That really just means you're gonna go find somewhere and hole up for a while, because that's what the game is basically gonna put you up against. Because now, right now, Silvalum, despite its relatively melodic theme, is incredibly dangerous. Everything in this game is dangerous, and I think in general the soundtrack does a good job of doing that. But I think Silvalum being soft in both song and in the appearance of the world and still being intensely dangerous, I think makes it more impactful that he's not screaming at you. Because in his battle theme, he's screaming at you. Like, in some cases, he's literally screaming at you. But in this one, like I said, this song and Selica's theme, which has another insane like name, he's really dialing it down and saying like, no, these are the moments where like, this is about things being pretty and nice. And in the end, like, I spent a bunch of time in Silvalum, which is probably the most boring area, because the music is nice. And it's not, it doesn't feel like it's telling me that you're going to die here. It's just as inhospitable as anywhere else, but it doesn't feel as menacing as a consequence.
I guess that's something that, you know, maybe where the soundtrack does a really good job is, yeah, this is not an area where there's much to look at visually. You're not going to be kind of in, you might be in awe of some of the landscape, but not certainly not the colors or the maybe the different things that you find there. It is kind of, like you said, kind of plain and white, and which is certainly contrasting from some of the previous areas that you visit. But the music, again, really compels you to keep going in this place where maybe what you see isn't driving you forward, but what you hear is, right? Okay, this music is maybe fitting or memorable or yeah, just kind of giving momentum to an area that doesn't have it in other areas or in the same way that other areas had it, right? I can't remember which one it is, the one that's kind of more jungle themed or, you know, a lot of plants everywhere, different colors at night and different lights at night.
Primordia, I believe.
Primordia, yeah. Like that's a kind of place where you are compelled to look around and to go to new places to see new things. But Silvalum isn't like that. You're here to do things, but you're not necessarily going to be looking around everywhere and seeing all these wonderful sights. But instead, you can be treated to this this great track.
There's stuff to see, but it's usually stuff that's jumped out to get you. And at that point, the music flips the switch.
That's right.
And in this area, because the enemies hide so well, it's way worse. Mm. And they're usually like, when you get there, they're almost all like level 90 plus. So it's just, this area is an absolute nightmare to traverse.
We need to press on forward. So now we're off to Casey's final song of the night.
Yes, and this was a tough one because I knew I wanted to represent this game, and the game is Bravely Default, because the soundtrack is just, it's so interesting to me. Like the entire soundtrack, like, I just feel like lots of different instruments are used and it's just like very all over the place, yet all ties in together very well. And this, you know, is probably not the quote unquote best track on the soundtrack, but it was one that always stuck with me because it's associated with the city of Anchime, which is the land of sand and time, and when you go into it, it's actually, there's windmills and there's like a big clock, and those are both things I visually like. I like, you know, pocket watches and like seeing the gears move and stuff, or it's always been fascinating to me. So the song is entitled The Desert and the Huge Clock Country. We'll be right back. hand with what the actual city is. And it's just a, and I was talking with Jordan earlier, it's just a good representation of what the town is. And when you get in there, it just, it feels, you know, visually and with the soundtrack itself, like, it all ties together very nicely. And, you know, it's very believable, like, you know, that it sounds, that this soundtrack would be, you know, associated with this town. And it's just a, it's an interesting city itself, because it's just, like, interesting background stories, and there's side quests. And what's cool is, obviously, with Bravely Default and Bravely Second, you revisit, right? You revisit these towns and locations. So, you know, it sort of almost makes an even more significant, you know, place, especially for me, having gone through both, to be, like, the first time around, you know, I really like this city, it's super cool, and then, like, to revisit it again, you know, a couple years later when I played Bravely Second, and it's like, oh, it's just a very, very cool game. But, like, the soundtrack itself, like I said, is very sort of varied, but it's just very interesting. And I James, I think, he cut out a game that was on from Bravely Default, as well.
Yeah, I cut out Love's Vagrant, which is Ring of Bells theme, which is just this crazy, like, bombastic kind of romantic-y song for this romantic character, this probably tragicomic romantic character that he is, where he's projecting his confidence, and he's basically decided he's going to devote himself entirely to this woman he literally just met and how much he loves her. And it's sort of, the song's full of a little bit of false bravado. It's a little bit sappy, but that's kind of what he is. Revo, who composed both of these songs, actually, led up a team of composers for this game, which basically produced an unbelievable chain of work. What I think is interesting that you left out of the desert town theme, the desert and the huge clock, is that the song starts out with essentially a really fast 4-pattern beat, which is basically the same percussive sound that a pocket watch with multiple gears makes. It's the 4 gears clicking for every second of the hand. And that holds through the entire song in the background. The entire song is, we'll call it loosely, Arabic music themed, Arabian themed, mm-hmm. layered on top of the ticking of a pocket watch, which is, you know, meaningful because A, this is the town where you get the time wizard asterisk, and B, the town's central feature is a giant clock and you spend a bunch of time in it as a dungeon, and the mayor is also a time wizard, I think. Like, it's all in there, and so they put this, like, obvious reference to the town directly in the song, both in the themes it's using, because it's in the desert, by making it Arabian themed, but also by basically just burying the sound of a pocket watch under it. I mean, to the point where you can hear it clicking, like, it's tick, 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 tick. Like, on the downbeat, that's where the second hand moves. It's a really nice touch to the song, and it actually gives the song a sense of percussiveness that also ends up filtering through into the primary Arabian melody to kind of also reinforce that this is a second hand that's moving with the song. It's a really nice, like, double theming of the town and its place, where the art team worked really well with the music. Whereas his character themes in this game are unbelievable, though. Everything is. This is a really cool soundtrack.
And David has never played Bravely Default. No.
I mean, I can understand why, because it's got that bullshit ending. But, like,
but you could avoid it if you want.
You could, but I think you miss out on the most interesting scene in the game as a consequence.
It's on the list.
I think the combat and the soundtrack are so good that who really cares about the ending? Yeah, there's some consequence to it, obviously, but I think even just playing the game through, there's a lot to
That's
enjoy.
That's what YouTube's for.
Just the story through it. Yeah,
I do like the story.
The flower town also has a really neat theme, mm-hmm. Which is more like Spanish guitar themed stuff. It's pretty cool. This game's just got a good soundtrack.
All right. Before we press on, I'll just sign off Casey. He's got to take off a few minutes early on us.
Yep. Yeah, unfortunately.
Want to thank you for joining us tonight, going through those are some three solid songs, and we had fun talking about them.
Yes, and always a pleasure to be here. Like I said, sucks I have to bounce out a little early. Gotta get up bright and early in the morning, but you'll have to fill me in on these surprise games tomorrow because I hope I could get to bed.
I hope you can get to sleep. So it's like one of those things like Christmas morning where you just can't wait to find out what it is and you just can't sleep.
Yeah. It's going to be like 2 o'clock. I'm like, oh no.
I really wish I knew.
Casey, my hope is that we've, you know, started to crack David on the Bravely Default by bringing up this song and talking about some of the soundtrack.
Yeah,
so
get an episode.
Hopefully we've made a little bit of a dent there.
And you'll have to bring up the last story idea that we came up with yesterday. But before we get into all that, I'm going to head out. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, have a good one.
And,
all right. Later. See you, Case.
See you.
All right. So sticking with the desert theme. Jordan's final.
Yes, I didn't even realize that, but that's cool. So my final song, my third song here, is Rivers in the Desert from Persona 5. Composer is Shoji Meguro. Is obviously an outstanding soundtrack. I think all the Persona games have had really good music. We just got the news that actually Joker just launched today for Smash Bros. And I believe Rivers in the Desert is one of the songs that the inclusion of Joker is bringing to Smash Ultimate. So I'm looking forward to hearing that arrangement of the song actually the whole way through. Hopefully someone will throw that up on YouTube soon. But even just the original Rivers in the Desert from the game soundtrack is really solid. It has vocals from Lin Inazumi, which are awesome. It's the Rivers in the Desert, that's kind of the boss theme for the game. It starts out really subtle and subdued for about the first 40 seconds. It doesn't seem like a typical boss theme necessarily, just because it is very, very quiet, I guess, as it builds up. But like I said, when you get to about 40, 45 seconds in, you start to hear some of the words from the song title, the pace, the tension of the song really picks up. Again, the Persona series is really well known for excellent music that has lyrics and singing to it as well, vocals. But this song, you get the instrumental version and the version with singing in it as well throughout the game. So you do get to hear both of those, which is cool. The song kind of plays out in waves. It seems to go back and forth between being that soft and quiet segment and then a faster section that always starts with the phrase, a river in a dry land. And as soon as those first four or five words get hit and it builds up again, then you start to realize, oh yeah, this is a really great track to listen to kind of on a loop as you play through. I mean, Persona games are notorious for having really long boss fights where the health just never goes down, or they've got two or three or 10 forms. Like, I mean, I think Persona 3 it might have been the worst for that in terms of a boss having, you know, just multiple forms at the end. But when you've got a song like this playing throughout or looping throughout, you know, 4 or 5 minutes on loop maybe, it makes up for that a little bit. You do get to hear some really great music for a long time, so that's not too bad. Now, I know both of you guys have played Persona 5. Is this one of your top songs? What do you think about this one?
I salute you for even being able to pick one. Because I was looking at that soundtrack, yeah. And like, man, I don't even know where to start.
It's really good. I don't know that when I walked out, so I didn't listen to any of the music until I was done. Because I mean, just, you know, spoilers. Like, you couldn't Google anything without getting it immediately spoiled
for sure.
So this was probably one of the ones in there, but the credit theme for the game, the ending theme, Hoshi to Bokura to, I believe, is probably the one that, like, if I had to pick one from this, would be the one I'd go with, because it's really good too. But yeah, this game has a really good soundtrack. I'm not sure if I like it more than 3's. I kind of like the cheesy rap in 3 a little
bit. I do too. Yeah, yeah. I find myself listening to 3 kind of just a little bit more regularly than 5 for whatever reason. It's maybe it's better traveling music, or it's very chill. I really like 3's.
Yeah, it doesn't songs. 5 explodes at you a little bit.
It does. Yeah.
I just like how they
I wouldn't want to
they kind of have like each game has its style, and they're so much different from each other. But they stick to the style throughout the game.
Yeah, I mean, they basically bring in a composer to make the game and basically oversee the game's process, and that person sets the tone for what they want to do. But it also tends to go with, you know, they basically made them color coded at this point, thanks to Persona 3, 4, and 5. So like this, and it even shows up in the Joker stage where they actually color code the stage based on what music we're playing. Which I would be doing that right now if A, I wasn't recording this podcast, and B, a Nintendo server went on fire.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah,
it's all gone wrong.
Rivers in the Desert has a really nice component to it where it gets really quiet and soft, and almost a little bit melodic as opposed to the little bit more triumphant parts. And then it kind of builds up again and kind of hits you with those Rivers in the Desert lyrics again. And so, yeah, it's got a lot of nice peaks and valleys that kind of help you get through the boss fights, those longer fights. And this is one that sticks with me, again, out of a soundtrack where everything is really, really listenable. Definitely music you don't necessarily need to listen to while you're playing a video game. Like I think either these are on Spotify or you can access them pretty easily, these soundtracks. So
I think they're on iTunes as well.
Yeah, it's cool. I mean, they're obviously music that you could just pick up and play anytime, and it's really good anyway. So yeah.
All right, we're on to the surprises. So
the surprises, so, here we go.
Initially, I didn't have this on my list at all, and I'm curious to see if you guys will figure it out based on the reasons why I wasn't going to include it. So I'll start naming off the reasons, and then just jump in if you think you know what it is.
Oh, is this like a trivia contest now?
Sort of. It's just a fun little mini game. Yeah. So the first reason is I this is from a Final Fantasy game, and I already went with Final Fantasy VIII, so one reason. Second reason, this isn't really a video game song. Like this was a song that existed. This is a song that existed before video games even were a thing.
Yeah, I know. Oh, I know what it is. I'm curious if, and you David, that I know what it is. I'm curious if James does. So I'm gonna give
the
it, give
the
it
version
going.
That appears in the game is a cover of this very old song, that is sung by a contemporary alt rock band.
Okay.
Any guesses, James? Do you have an idea about what it is?
You've given me almost nothing to work with right now.
Yeah, so it's from a recent Final Fantasy game. It's the end credits, like during the very, like after you've beaten the game.
It was also part of the marketing, the initial marketing of the game as well. Like at preview events or when they were first showing off the game. And I think the first trailer for the game or major trailer, they played this.
It was
song
also a very popular 80s movie.
What?
It is the Florence and the Machine version of Stand By Me.
Oh,
I love it so much. So what? So when Final Fantasy 15 ends, so they're one of the mechanics in the game is that, like, as Prompto, you can take pictures of, like, of your escapades, let's call them. And so throughout the game, I'm taking pictures, like, of stuff that looks cool. And after the game is completed and Noctis gives his life to save his friends, the pictures, all the pictures that you take are kind of going through, like, you know, Ken Burns style, going through each of the pictures. Right. And the song that's playing during it is Stand By Me by Florence and the Machine.
Oh, yes, God, it is.
But it felt so, because really to me, like, Final Fantasy 15 is really just a game about friends. Like, there are four guys. Like, the whole point of it is that this was supposed to be, like, the final time where the four of them would be together, because Noctis was getting married. He was going to be king or whatever. He was, you know, and so this was kind of like the last hurrah for these guys. And instead of, you know, instead of him going off to his wedding, they end up in this war that ends with, like, Noctis leaving his friends for 10 years to have, like, a nap and a crystal, and coming back and, like, the world has ended.
And one of his friends turning yeah, exactly. into Daredevil.
And
one of his friends being a bad guy, but it's yep. okay, because friendship.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah, this game is stupid. I know, but it's shit. So...
That worst. Song just made it for me, because I'm like, oh man, like, that this is what the game is. It's friends, like, coming together, and it was just it's such a perfect way to end, you know.
David, it's actually a perfect way to begin as well, because this song plays in the introduction of the game as well. Like, really early on, when you first get in the car and the car breaks down, if you remember this, you're pushing the car down the road, and this song is playing in the background very softly, probably not as pronounced as it is during the ending theme, but this song does kind of bookend the entire game. The friends are kind of supporting each other at the beginning, right? Stand By Me. But then that also happened as well when Noctis makes that sacrifice, and, you know, he needs his friends to kind of support him as well as he's done through maybe that sacrifice. So yeah, it is kind of cool that the way they use the song and the lyrics of the song, but it is just a really great version of it yeah. as well, right? Like, I think everyone's pretty familiar with Stand By Me. I remember it's the kind of song, like, you would sing in elementary school, like, at, you know, the winter concerts or spring concerts. Mm-hmm. That's where I remember it from. But this version of the song really got me interested in the game, actually. Like, I was like, you know, oh, later Final Fantasy games, Final Fantasy 15, I don't really care, looks like this boy band thing. But then I saw those first trailers and they put this music to it. I'm like, oh, this song is really, really good. Maybe I want to check out this game.
And it's on Spotify as well, if you want to listen to it. But I like Florence and the Machine as a band, so that was another, like, reason why it resonated with me. But Final Fantasy 15 certainly has bipolar the you either love it or you hate it sort of thing, you know.
Yeah, it seems that way. And it has some good music, actually. But one of the reasons why it has good music is because it has a tape player in your car, where you can buy the sound, basically buy the soundtracks to previous Final right. Fantasy games. And they're actually really good versions of those tracks too. So yeah, it is a good way
we
to
had
end
an episode
this
about when we went through all the Final Fantasies, and I was talking to Johnny Metz about because he enjoyed the game too. And I know, like, they take a lot of shit for how long you're sitting in a car going from place to place. But when you throw on one of those classic Final Fantasy songs, and you're just saying, nah, I'm good. I'll write it out. I don't need to skip. I'll just listen to the song.
Oh, the game is insufferable. By the way, all of our plots in a movie you have to watch separately, so... That's a you problem, not a me problem. Oh, by the way, that movie's only available on a $40 Blu-ray. Have fun. Fuck you.
I didn't say the game was faultless.
If you said that, I would just hang up the call.
David, that's putting it very nicely. That's a euphemism I've ever heard one. Oh, man.
How's the DLC coming?
I think they finally... Yep. finished it. Like I know they
just stopped.
That's I know they stopped. But I think the last one that they kind of promised just came out. Right? Yeah, yeah.
And we're gonna explain all the extra story we were missing. Yeah. But you got to pay us first.
Yeah.
Stay it did, it did not review it. The greatest that deal that final DLC.
No. Oh, it didn't. Yeah. Well.
By the way, you're all done after this. Yeah. Do a good job. No, I can imagine.
Hope you're not looking forward to FF16 anytime soon.
Hey, that DLC that you guys thought was really cool. Yeah, yeah. Don't stop thinking.
Yeah.
No, that's right. All right, James, take us home with the.
All right, so this one I've actually spent a little bit of time going back and forth on. And I'm going to go ahead and stick with my initial reaction here. So this is a JRPG. I don't care what you say. And I'll prove it. This game has not random battles, but battles where you see the enemy coming and then they run after you and you fight them. It has a leveling up system. It has a skill tree where you assign points to get new skills and new power-ups. You do magic on your enemies and destroy them. You kill thousands of enemies, mostly nameless. It's fine. Not technically nameless, but mostly just nothing. And then eventually you beat a big boss who also does magic. This game is Yakuza 6.
okay, I was not thinking that. That's great.
Because guess what? The Yakuza series are JRPGs. They just happen to have an action system to them. And Kiryu is the most powerful boss. But the specific song here, although I think it shows up in Yakuza 5 as well, is one of the songs you can take hostesses with you to karaoke to sing. And it's called Like a Butterfly.
I gotta hear this. I like the music in that series a lot, so I wanna hear this one.
Specifically, Saki singing it, and this is the actress who plays her because this series is obsessive, and so they face scanned these people to be hostesses. Most of them sing their own music. Saki here is a professional wrestler as well, in real life, not just although in the game as well. She actually sings really well. She sings really well. It's good for a couple reasons. One, she's singing really melodically and there's this really kind of rock theme behind it.
Yeah.
But then Kiryu starts rapping. And oh my.
The rapping is so bad. Oh my god.
Oh my god, it's amazing.
Rapping is horrible.
It's so, but you know what? It sticks in there because he's doing a good job at a bad thing. And it, like, the song is really cheesy. Like, it's got this really hard rock beat behind it, but it's not going anywhere. It's just dun dun da 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 dun dun da 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 dun dun dun. It just loops over itself.
I mean, it's anime, right? It's an anime introduction or end theme, right? That's exactly what it is.
And then she comes in and she sings great. You're like, whoa, this is nice. And there's a couple of different people who sing it, who sing the exact same song. But then so the karaoke in this game, like, it'll play music, and if you're doing well, it'll jump to, like, a dream sequence for every song. It's always appropriate. Sometimes it's, like, Kiryu looking at a picture of someone he lost in this bar singing mournfully. In this one, it jump cuts to her singing on a sound stage in this beautiful dress, and she's all glamorous, and then you see Kiryu doing rap hand gestures at you, wearing these, like, ridiculous sunglasses.
I thought they were VR goggles. That's how ridiculous those sunglasses are.
So it's those wraparound sunglasses from the 80s, basically. Yeah, yeah. The ones that are like a solid surface. Oh, and he's metal trimmed them. And he's like doing arm gestures and the camera's freaking out. Well, then it cuts back to her. She's being all glamorous, and then he's back being like a like the Terminator, just going nuts on screen. It's fantastic. But the thing is, the song's actually kind of good, even though the rap is terrible.
I think you need the video. This video with the music is really good.
So there's a longer version of the song where they've remixed all three women who sing it.
Okay.
And I'll include that one too. But
yeah,
like,
it's worth looking at.
It's so stupid and beautiful. Yeah. Like, especially when he just like, she has this nice part where she sings off, and all you can hear is yeah. it's like yes, no, I needed that in my life.
It kind of the music kind of perfectly epitomizes the game series itself, which is just so wacky and stupid. It doesn't take itself seriously, and that's what makes it so good, right?
Except when it does. Except when it gets super serious. Yeah, it's great. But like, it's actually a decent song too. Like I've listened to the song a bunch of times at some point. She's probably not the best singer of it. I think Renoa's probably a little bit better, or Riona. But they're all really kind of good, especially because most of them are just like, oh. It got better. At one point, he was just hiring like adult film actresses to do the to do the hostess job because the producer of this game's a lunatic.
Yeah.
But like, these are like talented singers. This song in particular is composed by a guy who named who just goes by Zenta in the game, but it's Zenta Tsuchihashi. He basically just done these games and a bunch of like fucking anime. Not anime, specifically like, oh, it's fucking like Cancole collection. You're like, oh god, oh god, why? But he's composed like 5 or 6 karaoke themes in this game, and so the other one I was thinking about was in Yakuza 5, which is one of Haruka's theme songs, because in that game you play a pop idol,
yeah,
and they're really good poppy music. Like, they're the kind of thing you could go into a karaoke studio and hear someone sing.
I can't get over that first link you posted, James, at the 126, 127 mark, when Kiryu says, fly like a beautiful butterfly.
Yeah, he's just screaming so English good. In the background.
Yeah, and then there's a butterfly flying outside of the bar that they're in.
Yeah.
I like when he just starts screaming, fly high in the background. It's just like, yeah, there he is. Like, the song will get good again. Like, oh, Kiryu's gone. Okay. And then he just starts screaming. And you're like, nope, he's back. Never mind.
That is classic, man.
I love it. I love it. It's so good. I actually have listened to the song independent of the game, because there's the remix where they're all singing. Like, it sort of levels out the fact that none of them are professional singers. But he's still there being a lunatic in the background. So God bless him.
Yeah. Well, he seems like he's having a good time, at least.
Oh, he's so having a good time. Like, you could tell the people who make this game are having way too much fun.
Well, it is a series I've wanted to get into.
I wish I could tell you, like, I mean, I could say start at zero, but, like, from there, I don't know what to tell you to do, because, like, 6 makes no sense to start with. Kiwami's not good, because it feels like an add-on to 0, but you got to get through it. It's like, oh god, where do you start this long and sprawling 400 hours of your life? That will
I played Zero. Zero's pretty good. Like, I think that probably is the it's got the you know, updates and quality of life stuff.
It's
that,
it's what you do after
have,
Zero that things get tough.
That's it. I've only played Zero through. I've kind of dabbled in the other ones. I probably will play. They were giving away Kiwami 1 on PSN as one of the PS Plus games, which is cool. So I've got that ready to go. I just need to find time for it. But
it's pretty short compared to the others. 2 is long. 3 is long. 4 is long. 5 is, oh my god, why? and then 6 is super short because they had a new engine. And they were like, we don't have time to put content in this engine.
Yeah.
But... yeah, it's a dumb series that will make you cry because it has that power.
Well, we've got Judgment coming this year, and that might make us cry, or maybe we get some of the beautiful soundtrack moments like we just saw here with Yakuza 6.
And there's like 10 of these. Like, I could have picked any song, and you just at some point, like, the one set in the 80s. Oh my god.
I'm gonna have to put the link to this one in the description, I guess.
Yeah, it needs video to go with.
You gotta watch that video.
It's outrageous. There's a song in this series called Machine Gun Kiss, and he says it in English in the middle of the song. So there you go. That's what you're getting with this dumbass series.
Oh, man. Well, what a way to end our favorite songs of the our first. I'm sure we could.
Yeah, that was definitely a surprise.
I'm sure we could fill a few more episodes with this kind of style of going through songs. So I'm sure there will be another one. But
oh yeah.
That was fun. It was funny to see how eclectic really it was. Like, we really only had two overlaps of composers. And we missed some big, like, there's no Shimomura.
Yeah, like, I didn't go that way because I figured, you know, I wanted to put Yakuza in there as to be an outlier. But, like, I figured, oh, somebody's going to get the Shimomura. Rei and Historia's soundtrack is stunning. It came with a piano CD that I've listened to an ungodly amount of number of times. But yeah, we're right. She's composed everything good in this world. And I know we didn't mention her.
I mean, it's the trouble of only picking three songs and also not, you know, trying to avoid maybe picking what we think are the best songs, right? We're going to try to pick personal favorites or just things that stick out to us. So you're someone great like Shimomura, you're going to gravitate maybe away from her because all of her stuff is so excellent. You're like, oh, okay, I'm gonna let how about some lesser known stuff that people aren't as familiar with, maybe?
Yeah, like, yeah, because I didn't even think to go there because I'm like, well, somebody will handle her, right?
Well, that's how I went with Persona 5 because I was like, I have to have a Persona 5 one on here, but then I'm like, yeah, somebody's gonna do it. Same with when I took off my Chronicles 2, like, I was like, somebody's gonna mention Mitsuda, so
yeah, in the end, two people did, and like. I almost mentioned him twice, so things could have gotten way out of hand for Mitsuda. But yeah, if you haven't heard Rei and Historia's soundtrack, go listen. It's goddamn amazing. Yoko Shimomura is a genius. Have fun. Have fun with any song on that. The entire soundtrack is amazing.
Oh, didn't Casey remove Shimomura, didn't he? I think he was. Yeah, I think he was.
He might have, yeah.
I don't remember what his fourth one was.
The forest theme from... Mario
you might
RPG,
be right.
So
you might be right.
She was that close.
Yes, yes. That's what he had. Yeah,
that's all right. Well, I'm sure we'll have another episode at some point, and she'll be well represented in the next one. I'm sure. Mm-hmm.
I hope they didn't ruin it in perfect chronology. I still haven't started it yet. I'm so disgusted by what they did to the visuals.
I
fear for the music.
I mean, I played that went through that and. I enjoyed it. I immediately didn't play the original though, so I can't comment on
original art available for your purchase.
Yeah, that's a problem. That's a problem.
They're holding the good art hostage.
Yeah,
you gotta bastards. Make money
not that way. Not that way.
By selling the game the first time.
Well, they managed to wait in both cases until the platform that they released the game on was like good and dead.
Yeah, we hired the composer for New Yoshi's Island to do the music. If you want the real music, pay us $100.
Oh man.
Oh, here's my money.
Yeah, you end up doing it anyways.
You monsters.
Well, if I'm going to pay any extra money for better music, it would be Shimomura's.
We replaced your music with kazoos. Have fun.
Alrighty, well, better wrap it up here. And want to thank both James and Jordan for joining me tonight and reminiscing on some fantastic music. I guess I'll just sign off by saying check out Nintendo World Report. Both podcasts are hosted there. You'll be able to hear... if you haven't already heard the episode this week from Radio Free Nintendo, definitely pick that up. And you can also follow us on Twitter at thethirstymage. At thethirstymage is our handle. And make sure to also follow Jordan and James on Twitter as well. And hopefully you enjoyed it. And you're listening to some. You'll be listening to some fantastic music after this to follow up. And hope you enjoyed the show.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. We'll be right back.
Thank you.